Good morning and welcome to worship at First Baptist Church of Greenville. We're so glad that you've chosen to worship with us today. And it is our prayer that together, whether we're in person or watching online or by way of television, that together we join in and worship the Lord in spirit and in truth, because He is worthy of our worship today. So join us as we worship in song, as we open God's Word and hear it preached. May the Holy Spirit speak to us, convict us where we need conviction, and encourage us where we need encouragement. And together we can say that it has been good to be in the presence of the Lord today. Thank you for being with us.
Well, good morning. I welcome you here on a beautiful Lord's Day. We're glad to have everyone in His house. We pray that we worship Him in spirit and in truth. Our first block of music today is about worship itself. And, of course, a lot of us know what worship is, but some people are misinformed. They think worship is the singing or the listening to the preaching. But worship is our response to who God is. And that includes all of those things, including how we live our life every day and every minute. Let's stand as we worship together, worthy of worship.
Worthy of praise, worthy of honor and glory, worthy of all that Thy song sing and sing, worthy of all that we offerings we bring, You are worthy.
And thank you. Be seated as we continue in our time of worship.
Amen, amen. Let's read Psalm 5. Follow along with me as we read and prepare our hearts to continue worshiping the Lord this morning. Listen to my words, Lord. Consider my sighing. Pay attention to the sound of my cry, my King and my God, for I pray to you. In the morning, Lord, you hear my voice. In the morning, I plead my case to you and watch expectantly. For you are not a God who delights in wickedness. Evil cannot dwell with you. The boastful cannot stand in your sight. You hate all evildoers. You destroy those who tell lies. The Lord abhors violent and treacherous people. But I enter your house by the abundance of your faithful love. I bow down toward your holy temple in reverential awe of you. Lord, lead me in your righteousness because of my adversaries. Make your way straight before me. For there is nothing reliable in what they say. Destruction is within them. Their throat is an open grave. They flatter with their tongues. Punish them, God. Let them fall by their own schemes. Drive them out because of their many crimes, for they rebel against you. But let all who take refuge in you rejoice. Let them shout for joy forever. May you shelter them, and may those who love your name boast about you. For you, Lord, bless the righteous one. You surround him with favor like a shield. Let us pray. Father, we bow before you and we agree with the psalmist today, Lord, that we want to honor you. We want to, Lord, be known by you. And Lord, we need your presence over us today. Lord, forgive us for where we have failed your holy name. Lord, we are here to worship you. Lord, we do exist to worship you each and every day. And so, Father, prepare our hearts now as we corporately, collectively join in this worship hour. Lord, may you receive the praise from our lips. But Lord, as we open your holy word, may you also speak to us. Convict us, Lord, where we need conviction, but also encourage us today where we need encouragement. And Lord, we ask it all in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Thank you. finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay. The last thing I need is to be heard, but to hear what you would say. Speak, won't you pour down like rain?
Amen. Amen. Revelation 21, Revelation chapter 21 this morning, as we are going to look at why the church matters. We're jumping ahead to Revelation 21, but 2 weeks from today, we're actually going to begin a journey through the letter of Revelation. And so we will follow the Lord's leading and begin Revelation 2 weeks from today. So I pray that you'll be praying for that, but also come expectant to worship the Lord and hear from the Lord in this great letter of Revelation and what God has to say. But this morning, we're going to see what God has to say about the importance of the church. You know, we live in a day and age in which the church has been diminished, maybe downgraded in the eyes of many, or we hear things like, well, I love God, I'm going to heaven, but the church really doesn't matter. And that is far from a New Testament biblical understanding. What we know from Scripture is that repeatedly God calls the church His bride. And so saying that we love God but don't love the church is like saying that we want to be married but we don't want to be faithful to our spouse. If you love God and want to serve God and honor God, then the church has to matter in our life. And we're going to see straight from John's vision in Revelation, going all the way to the end of all of this, when all is said and done, why the church matters. Now, there are a lot of places we could look in the New Testament, because from the moment that Jesus founded the church and set the church in motion forward, church has been critical. It's been crucial to carry out the mission of God, to carry out the Great Commission, to be salt and light. But number one, to worship God and to show the world what worship of the one true God is. But what we find at the end of all of it is that the church is still around. The church still matters. And God has a word for us today straight from Revelation 21. So the question before us today is, are we living with the understanding that the church is crucial in my life and your life today? Not a second thought, not a maybe, but crucial. Look with me, beginning in Revelation 21. We're going to look at the first 8 verses. John says, "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. I also saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared like a bride adorned for her husband. Then I heard a loud voice from the throne, 'Look, God's dwelling is with humanity, and He will live with them. They will be His peoples, and God Himself will be with them and will be their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Grief, crying, and pain will be no more, because the previous things have passed away.' Then the one seated on the throne said, 'Look, I am making everything new.' He also said, 'Write, because these words are faithful and true.' Then he said to me, 'It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. I will freely give to the thirsty from the spring of the water of life. The one who conquers will inherit these things, and I will be his God, and he will be my son. But the cowards, faithless, detestable, murderers, sexually immoral, sorcerers, idolaters, and all liars, their share will be in the lake that burns with fire and sulfur, which is the second death.'" Are we living with the understanding that the church is crucial in my life and your life today? Why? Well, first of all, the church exists eternally. First thing we see from Revelation 21 is that the church exists eternally. Look what John says in verse 1 when he says, "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth." Now, this entire letter, and learn more about this in the coming weeks, but this entire letter is a vision that John had. It's why it's called Revelation, not Revelations, but Revelation, because it is the revelation that John received on the island of Patmos about the things that are to come. Many times we read it and we may come away afraid at some of the imagery and visions that John saw, and we're going to get to all of that in due time. But what John saw in Revelation is a beautiful thing, because what John saw in Revelation is that God is in control. And that's why I think it is a time that we as a church walk through the letter of Revelation, because we need to know, and Christians need to know, and the church needs to know today, that God is still on the throne, that God is in control, that God has the final say, and that for those who trust in the blood of Jesus Christ, it's all going to be okay. And so John has received a vision throughout this letter. It's a vision of many things and about the end, and how Jesus is going to show his final reign in the end, and what's going to happen to those who are on God's side by the blood of Jesus Christ, and sadly, what's going to happen to those who choose to live their life opposed to Jesus Christ. But one thing that John sees here to the end is he says, after all of this is done, he says, I saw a new heaven and a new earth. This final consummation of all things, this magnificent vision that John has, he gets to the end of it when all of it is about to come to a conclusion. And he says, after all was done, I saw a new heaven and a new earth. As chapter 21 opens, and we'll know this later as we walk through the turn of events in Revelation, but when chapter 21 opens, all sinners of all ages, of stages and ages of life, meaning periods of time, all sinners who have ever lived, who are not repentant sinners, who have not been covered by the blood of Jesus Christ, including Satan, including the demons, including the beast that arises, including the false prophet, everybody that is opposed to Jesus in the work of God, by this point in Revelation 21, are locked away in the lake of fire forever. That's why verse 8 we read when he says, we'll look at this in a moment, but the cowards, the faithless, the detestable, the murderers, the sexually immoral, the sorcerers, idolaters, and liars, their share will be, look how awful he describes it, the lake that burns with fire and sulfur, he says, which is the second death. Let me just stop right there and say that God has made a provision in Jesus Christ that nobody would have to face this. But the truth is, hell will be populated at the end. Why? Because there are generations and generations and generations who choose not to bow the knee to Jesus Christ, who choose not to live with Jesus as Lord, who choose to use this short amount of time that we have on earth. Even if you get 90 or 100 years, it is a short amount of time compared to eternity, who choose to live this time selfishly and for self instead of honoring God. And the Bible is very clear that if you're covered by the blood of Jesus Christ and live repentantly to follow him and serve him in this life, then you will be welcomed into all eternity with him. But the Bible is also very clear that if you choose to live this life not bowing the knee to Jesus Christ, that you will face the second death. And the second death is not a ceasing to exist. The second death is an eternal death, just as much as those covered by the blood of Jesus Christ experience eternal life. And by this point in Revelation, when 21 opens, all who oppose Jesus have been locked away forever. You do realize that Satan is not in hell today. The Bible says that he is roaming the earth, seeking whom he can devour. He's not omnipresent. He's not omniscient like God is. He is limited in his knowledge. He is limited in his presence of being able to be everywhere all at once. He's not like God in that state. But he has a host of demonic forces. That's why Ephesians 6 says that every day we wake up, we are to stand firm in the faith, and we're to put on the whole armor of God, because we wage a war every day that is not of flesh and blood, but it is of this present darkness. What is Paul talking about? He's saying every day you wake up, you have a spiritual battle that's going on around you, and whether Satan is there or not, his demonic forces are. He's roaming the earth today. And the day is coming, though, when Jesus comes back on that white horse and we experience the Battle of Armageddon, and Jesus, with one short secondary act defeats Satan for all eternity. And the Bible says he holds the keys of death and Hades, and he is going to be locked away forever. And that is what heaven is, heaven because God is there and Satan has no access to it. That's why those who live in eternity with God will never face pain or grief or any effect of sin. It's because Satan and everybody who refuses to bow the knee to Jesus Christ will be locked away for all eternity. It's not happening right now. That's why we have sin prevalent in the world. But when Revelation 21 opens, the battle will be done. He will be locked away, and all who refuse to honor God will be locked away with him. And so that's where we are when we come to the opening of chapter 21. And the whole universe as we know it right now has been destroyed. God creates a new heaven and a new earth, John says, when he sees that. Because he says the first heaven and the first earth have passed away and the sea was no more. Meaning there was no more separation. And we'll see in just a minute as this unfolds that we are in the presence of God for all eternity. But in this new dwelling place, all the former things will be destroyed. All that we know it right now. God is going to recreate what has been stained by his original creation. Now, when God created the universe in Genesis, it was perfectly good. Because God does nothing that is not perfectly good. But sin entered the world and stained God's creation. So when Jesus comes again, before the final time is done, God is going to recreate his creation. And thankfully, if we're covered by the blood of Jesus Christ, and if you are a part of the church, you are, because the church exists of those who are the body of Christ, the bride of Christ, believers in Jesus Christ. Guess what? You and I will get to experience God's new creation for all eternity. And think how wonderful even this creation is. When you go places and you travel places and you see the wonderful handiwork of God, maybe you just walk out your back door and you see the wonderful handiwork of God and you know only God could do this. Think about what it's going to be like in eternity when you experience fresh and new God's wonderful creation. You see, the day's coming when all of this that we know it will be no more except the church. Except the church. This earth is not eternal. The Bible says he's going to do away with it. He's going to create new heavens and a new earth. But the church is eternal. What do I mean by that? I mean you and I. You see, we are the church. This building is not the church. Localized places of gathering are not the church. Last night, maybe you saw the news, tragically, the historic chapel at First Baptist Dallas burned down. Been around for a long, long time. Lots of theological history there. Wonderful staple in Dallas, Texas. It exists no more. But the church still exists because the church is not the building. You see, it's just a reminder of how all things that we know it come and go. Life changes, even within our span of life now, that is we're not in eternity yet. Things change. We grow older. People come in our life and they go out of our life. We experience good times and we experience difficult times. But the Bible says that we, as the body of Christ, will be around for all eternity. Believers are the church. And that's why when we gather together, it means a whole lot. Because we need each other to grow and to prepare ourselves for heaven. You do realize this life is a preparation for eternity. This life is not just about existing. It's not just about wanting our needs met or our opinions or living for ourselves. But everything we do in this life is a preparation or lack thereof for eternity. And so why did Jesus call us to gather together as the body of Christ to meet regularly? Well, number one, it's to worship and honor God because you're going to be doing that in all eternity. But secondly, it's to learn how to get along. And it's to learn how we are to love one another and be there for each other, because in all of eternity, there's going to be perfect unity. And so the church needs to begin to practice that today. Do you realize the significance of the body of Christ? It's not something to take lightly. It's not something to abuse. It's not something to make an afterthought of your life. It is your identity as a believer. You are the church. And it's your future as a believer, because in eternity we will be with Him forever. You and I will exist together with God and by God's standards for all eternity. That's why God's word matters. Secondly, the church exists to equip for the great marriage celebration. What in the world do I mean by that? Well, look at verse 2. He said, I also saw what we just sang about. The holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared like a bride adorned for her husband. In this new creation, John sees the ancient holy city, Jerusalem. Jerusalem has always been, from Old Testament time forward, a holy place for God's people. It was a place of worship once the temple was built. And in the Bible, one always traveled up to Jerusalem, never down to Jerusalem. Even if you were south, traveling north to Jerusalem, north traveling south to Jerusalem, you never went down to Jerusalem. You always went up. Why? Because it was the pinnacle for God's people. You were always going up to worship. It was not about geography. It was about theology. Always going up to Jerusalem. Jerusalem was important in the New Testament. Jerusalem is important today. And Jerusalem will be important when Jesus comes back. John sees the holy city, referred to as the New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven for God, prepared like a bride adorned for her husband. Marriage is also important to God. The New Testament repeatedly refers to the church as what? The bride of Christ. So what do we see here in verse 2? We see there is a great marriage coming. John describes it. All saints will gather, referred to as the holy city here in verse 2. It's the gathering of all the saints, meaning not the football team, not some extra religious people, but if you are a believer in Jesus Christ, the New Testament refers to you as a saint. And what we have in verse 2 is all believers gathered together coming to meet their groom, Jesus Christ. This is what we have in verse 2. It's like a bride, he says, adorned for her husband. Now, we know the New Testament talks about the church, us, as the bride of Christ. And we are in that betrothal period right now. I've told you before, especially around Christmas time, when we think of Mary and Joseph, they were in that betrothal period. And what in the world does that mean? Because it's not a part of our modern marriage ceremonies. But that was a time when the groom would come. He would propose to his wife. It was legally binding once the engagement period started or the betrothal period started. But then during the betrothal period, he would go back most of the time to his parents' home, and he would begin preparing a dwelling place for he and his new bride. And once the dwelling place was prepared, then he would go back, he would get his bride, and the great marriage celebration would begin. And that's where Joseph and Mary were. And that's why Jesus says in John 14:6, what does he say? Or John 14:1-6, he says, I am going to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again to get you, to take you that where I am, you may be also. They would have known perfectly what Jesus was talking about there, because their mind would have went to any groom and bride situation. He's like the groom preparing the place. And when the place is ready, he will come and get the church. That is exactly what we see here in Revelation 21:2. Right now, Jesus is preparing the eternal place. And whenever the Father says it is time, he's going to come again and he's going to take the church. And we will experience, after all is said and done, the great marriage of the bride to Jesus Christ, and there we will be with him for all eternity. The church is at work today to get ready for eternity through sanctification, working out your salvation, learning what it means to walk in repentance, through worship, which we've talked about already and sang about this morning, through equipping for the work of the ministry. That is the purpose of the church. It's all to prepare us for that day where we finally meet Jesus face to face and begin living with him for all eternity. We cannot imagine what that day is going to be like. The most special day on earth that you've ever had cannot prepare you for how special that day is going to be. When you finally see Jesus face to face. So we must take church serious today, understanding that it is preparing us for the great marriage day between the bride of Christ and Jesus. We must learn to worship, because in heaven, all of heaven is going to be worship. Now, I think somewhere along the way, for whatever reason, we've got a wrong idea of that, because when I say that, your mind might go to an angel sitting on a cloud playing a harp. That's not what's going to be happening in heaven. First of all, humans are humans. We're not angels. And when you die, you don't become an angel. Angels are different created beings than humans. You and I are created in God's image, and we have an eternal soul, and we will be with God for all eternity. But when you die, you are going to be still created in the image of God. You're not going to become an angel. Worship for us, though, is going to be certainly singing. We find plenty of that in Revelation. It's going to be service before God. It's going to be a perfect taste of what we should already be doing. Paul says in Romans 12, 1 and 2, that our life is spiritual worship before God. And that's what worship is going to be like in heaven. You are eternally going to be living to perfectly bring glory to your Creator. Wonderful thing. And so the church prepares us for that, because one of the most selfish things we can do in church life today is make worship about us. Because let me tell you something, in heaven, it's not going to be about us. It's not going to be about me. It's not going to be about you. It's going to be all about God. Every vision that we get in Revelation about the throne room of God, you know where all the heavenly beings are, including humanity, including John, flat on their face before God. Why? Because they know it's all about Him. And that's how we should live our life today, making it all about God. We learn to get along despite our differences, because in heaven we're going to be perfectly unified. We learn to serve and work for Christ, because I believe in heaven we are. When God created Adam and Eve in the garden before sin came, they still had jobs to do. The only difference is the jobs didn't work against them. They did the jobs with delight. The groom is preparing our dwelling place, so we must prepare ourselves to meet Him. If Jesus were to come back for His church today, how would you feel? We need to ask ourselves that question. Would we be ashamed? Would we try to hurry and get things in right order? As if someone comes over to your house unexpectedly? Or would we be ready to meet Him? Because we're walking ready. Let me tell you something, and I think we're going to see more of this as we walk through the letter of Revelation, but the truth is, Jesus could come back today. I know you've heard it before, and maybe it's lost its meaning, but Jesus could come back at any time. And when Jesus comes back, let me say something else. Nothing that we think matters today is going to matter today. It's all going to be about where we stand before Him. In His presence. Are you ready for that day? Thirdly, the church exists to edify for God's presence. Exists to edify for God's presence. He says in verse 3, I heard a loud voice from the throne. Look, God's dwelling is with humanity, and He will live with them. They will be His peoples, and God Himself will be with them and will be their God. I want to stop right there and say that's the best part about heaven. The best part about heaven is God is there, we're there with Him, and there is nothing to separate us. There is no sin. We say often, we all do, and rightfully so, when we get to heaven, we can't wait to see this person, that person, our loved ones, and that's going to be a wonderful thing about heaven. We're going to be with them. We're never going to miss them again, with them forever. But you know what? The first person that we're going to want to see when we get to heaven is Jesus, because He's the reason we're there. He's the best part of heaven. God is there. Verse 4, He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Grief, crying, and pain will be no more, because the previous things have passed away. How wonderful this is. We as Christians who are ready for the coming of Jesus Christ, we shouldn't be fearful about the day we're living in. We shouldn't be fearful about the future. We shouldn't be fearful about election year. We shouldn't be fearful about anything that could come our way, health-wise, economic-wise, or whatever else, because we are ready for the King. And when Jesus comes back, we understand He is in control. We are on His side by His blood. And when we are in His presence for all eternity, verse 4 is going to be a reality. There will be no more death. There will be no more pain. We will never experience 1 ounce of pain in heaven. We can't imagine that. There will be no tears in heaven. Why? Because all the previous things have passed away. I love the song that came out a few years ago. It says the only scars in heaven are on Jesus, the one who died for us. You realize that? The only scars in heaven are not ones that we take there because he's healed all of those. But when you get to heaven and you see Jesus face to face, it gives me chills to even think about, you will be able to put your hands in his wrist where he was nailed for you. And see the holes in his feet where he was nailed to that cross for you. Can you imagine that? And you and I will know as we stand before him face to face and we see those scars on Jesus. Those scars are for me. And those scars are the only reason I have a place in heaven. We need to live with a heavenly perspective every day of our life. I think it would make us much more faithfully committed Christians and grateful worshipers. The church exists to edify us for God's presence. What does that mean? It means prepare us for God's presence. To prepare us to live and to honor and to worship God for all eternity. Because in God's presence, all things are new. There's no tears, sorrow, death, pain, none of those things. 1 Corinthians 15 is the great resurrection chapter of the Bible. And in 1 Corinthians 15, Paul is basically arguing with a faulty theology going around in the Corinthian church that they were being taught that the resurrection of Jesus Christ was not real. It was not a reality, that Jesus didn't really raise from the dead. That he was crucified, but he never came back to life. And many today who still believe that. And Paul says, if Jesus didn't come back to life, then why are we here? If Jesus didn't come back to life, then we are to be pitied above all people because we're believing in a false gospel. But Paul says, the reality is I know Jesus came back from the dead. I know he died on the cross. I know he was placed in the tomb. And I know 3 days later he rose from the dead because I have met him. I have witnessed him. And I have experienced him. And Paul says, because of that, death is swallowed up in victory. He says, oh, death, where is your sting? Oh, sin, oh death, where is your pain? Oh, sin, where is your sting? That's where we get the song, Victory in Jesus, from. Because there is victory in the resurrection. And because Jesus has risen from the dead, all of these sinful things will be no more. So are we seeking to be prepared to live in God's presence? Are we applying God's truth to our life? Selfless living with consistent worship, living repentant, living by the truth of the Word of God. He says, verse 5, the one seated on the throne says, look, I am making everything new. He also said, write, because these words are faithful and true. It's referring to Jesus there. Everything Jesus speaks is faithful and true because he is the Word of God. Lastly, the church exists to guide in endurance as it remains faithful to Jesus. The church exists to guide in endurance as it remains faithful to Jesus. Verse 6, then he said to me, it is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. Alpha and the Omega is the first and last letter in the Greek alphabet. Jesus is saying, I'm the beginning and the end. And he says, I will freely give to the thirsty from the spring of water of life. Salvation is free, but you must accept it. Salvation is already finished in the finished work of Jesus Christ. When Jesus died on the cross, he said, it is finished. He was not meaning he was giving up his life, though he did. He was meaning the sacrificial work for atonement is done. It is finished. And I will freely give to the thirsty from the spring of water of life. What did he say? He said that he is the spring of life. The spring of water welling up into eternal life. And look what he says in verse 7. The one who conquers will inherit these things, and I will be his God, and he will be my son. Freely give to those who thirst. The only requirement for salvation is that you thirst for the things of God. Can I ask you this morning, what are you thirsty for? Are you thirsty for the things of this world? Are you thirsty for selfish gain? What do I mean by that? I mean, what are you longing for? When you're thirsty, you long for something to quench your thirst. And when you get it, it means something to you. Because it has just met a need that if you didn't get it, you felt like you were about to die. And Jesus says the only requirement for salvation is that you thirst after Him. You will not be satisfied until He meets that thirst within you. And when He has filled that thirst, you're going to live the rest of your life living to honor Him. And He says to the one who thirsts, I will give from the spring of water of life. And that thirst will lead to conquering. He will inherit all of these things that I have talked about. And look what He says at the end of verse 7. I will be His God and He will be my son. I love that Jesus says there in verse 7, the one who conquers, because it reminds me of what happens in Revelation 12 in verse 11 when we're in the midst of a great battle and great tribulation here. And listen what John says. They conquered Him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony, for they did not love their lives to the point of death. He's talking about the overcomers there. He's talking about those who remain faithful to Jesus in the midst of the tribulation, in the midst of a world that's trying to pull them away from Jesus, in the midst of a false prophet who's trying to lead them astray. And John says what we as the church need to hear today, not giving in to this pressure or that pressure, not swaying on the truth of God's word, but being faithful to the end. And John says they overcome, number one, by the blood of the Lamb. Saved by Jesus Christ alone. They overcome, number two, by the word of His testimony, by remaining faithful to the word of God. And they overcome, number three, because they love Jesus more than they love this life. Is that you today? You're only ready for eternity if you can say those three things. I'm covered by the blood of Jesus Christ. I love the word of God because it is the one true word, and I'm going to remain faithful to it no matter what it costs me. Because the day, let me tell you something, we live in the day and it's only going to get worse when being faithful to the word of God is going to cost you more and more and more. And either you will stand for it or you will give out. And I had a seminary professor tell me many years ago, you can only run with the assurance of heaven when you run with the endurance of the word of God. Think about that. We cannot get to the end of this life and be assured that we will step into eternity prepared to meet Jesus, living for Him for all eternity, if we give up and we falter in this life at this turn and that turn and don't remain faithful to God's word. Only when you run with the endurance of Jesus Christ and God's word can you run with the assurance of heaven. And Jesus says they will overcome. And He ends all of this tragically. But the cowards, the detestable, the murderers, the sexually immoral, sorcerers, idolaters, liars. This is not an exhaustive list. But it's a representative list. And what He's talking about here are unrepentant sinners. We've all told a lie. But have you repented from that? Are you covered by the blood of Jesus Christ? And when you fail Him, does it cause you great shame within and lead you to the cross seeking His forgiveness and walking in repentance? But the Bible is very clear that if we live our life by the pattern of sin, unrepentant, making excuses for our sin and not living by the power of the Word of God, then we will be separated from God for all eternity in what He calls the second death, which we know is hell. Jesus says here, where the fire and the sulfur burn forever. The church exists to guide us today in endurance as it remains faithful to Jesus. So, are you prepared to be faithful to the body of Christ? Because we know these things are coming. Every head bowed and every eye closed this morning, let's think about what we've just heard from the Word of God. The day is coming, maybe sooner than we realize, where either we will exit this life or Jesus will come again. Do you know without any shadow of a doubt that you're prepared to meet Him for eternity? Do you know that you will be welcomed in His presence and received in His presence, not because you are religious or good, but because you trust in the blood of Jesus Christ? If you don't know that with 100% certainty today, then what's keeping you from that? He wants you to be assured of that, and all you have to do is come to Him, repent of your sins, and live your life to follow and serve Him. You can do that right where you, in just a moment, I'm going to pray and you in your own heart. This is a personal decision between you and God, but then you need to make it public so that you can honor Him and be led in the next steps of discipleship and faithfulness to grow in Him. Maybe you're here today and you're part of the church. You are a Christian, but the priorities of God have not really been priorities in your life. And you realize that in a moment when all is said and done, none of the things of this world are going to matter anymore because everything is going to be gone. Even the things that we place the most value on in this life, they're going to be gone and they will exist no more. And it's time that we turn our eyes off the world and the things of the world. And we turn our eyes to the kingdom of God. We turn our eyes to the church. We turn our eyes to the eternal reality of what is coming our way. Would you let the Holy Spirit just speak into your life this morning? And then give Him the obedience that He deserves. Father, we bow before You today. We thank You for the blood of Jesus Christ. We thank You that it is by that blood that we overcome. We thank You for Your word that is faithful and true. And God, we thank You for the equipping of Your Holy Spirit that enables us to live selflessly and no longer selfishly. Father, however You need to move in our hearts today, we pray that You would receive repentant hearts, that You would experience that, and God, that we would leave this place saying with 100% certainty that we are ready to meet You whenever that time comes. Lord, thank You for Your church. Help us be faithful to it. And we ask all of these things in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Thank you for joining us in worship today. I pray that the Lord has spoken to you in some way through our time of worship together and the preaching of His Word. If the Lord has laid a specific decision on your heart, please note the contact information there on your screen and reach out to us so that we can guide you in the next steps, whether it's a decision of faith, a recommitment to the Lord, or just a prayer need that you might have. Our staff is here ready to serve you. Thank you for being with us, and we hope that you will join us next time.